Hello comrades, you're watching RedIvanAirsoft, and today we'll talk about the Ukrainian Defense Forces field uniforms from 1991 till 2019. Also, here will be a short review of the 2015 version of the Ukrainian uniform made in MM14 camouflage pattern. Few things before we begin. First of all, since I'm from Odessa, my father is Russian, mother is Ukrainian, and also I have some Belarusian, Polish and Jewish roots, so no politics in the comments. Second thing is that since I have no affiliation with any governmental, military, secret research lab or whatever, most of the names in this video will be army nicknames or names given by collectors in order to systematize the information. And some dates also will be approximate. And the last thing is that we will talk only about Ukrainian made or Ukrainian developed or some Soviet gear and uniforms in this video. Otherwise, we would not have enough time. By 1991, when Ukraine gained its independence, it had all types of the Soviet military uniforms, such as M69, M88, also known as Afghanka or Experimentalka, different types of masking coveralls in the camouflage patterns, such as Kliaksa or Palma. But the main accent in Ukrainian army was made on the uniform in the camouflage pattern so-called Butan or Dubok. And the thing is that under the name of Butan or Dubok could hide at least three different camouflage patterns. So right now we'll try to talk about this in details and understand the difference between them. And we'll begin with a Soviet camouflage called Butan. Soviet Butan camouflage has different names, such as Butan, VSR-84 and TCKO. But none of them is an official name of the pattern. Butan is the name of the camouflage development project under which this camouflage was created. VSR-84 is an abbreviation given by collectors in order to systematize different Russian camouflages and stands for Вооруженные силы России 84, which can be translated as Russian Armed Forces 84. But as you all know, in 1984 there was no Russian army, there was Soviet army. And TCKO stands for трехцветная камуфляжная одежда or трехцветная камуфляжная окраска, which can be translated as tricolor clothes or tricolor camo, which technically could be any tricolor uniforms, such as Барвиха, for example. But since we don't know the official name of this camo, we will keep calling it Butan. So what we know about Butan is that Butan was developed in the beginning of the 80s, and there was two different cuts of this uniform. First one is naval infantry or marine cut, which was created in 1982, and VDV cut or airborne cut, which was created in 1983. Speaking about the Soviet pattern itself, it is 42 centimeters long before the repetition, and there were few types of this camouflage pattern. Right now you see A and B on your screen. However, my colleagues told me that there are C and D also around, and only God knows how many miscellaneous shades and color combinations were made during the Soviet times. And the same thing happened with Ukraine as well. Interesting fact is that in Ukraine this ideal Soviet type Butan pattern was produced without any changes all the way till 1997. Actually, till 1996 it was produced even with a stamp in Russian language, and in 1997 it was still produced but with Ukrainian stamp already. Some guys told me that the material for this camouflage was brought from Russia. But in this video, we care more about was it made in Ukraine or not, and yes, it was. This Butan uniform is Ukrainian made, produced in 1996, a Butan Type B. And the cap is Soviet made, produced in 1990, Butan Type A. In 1994, Ukraine began production of its own version of the Butan camouflage pattern, and we will call it Butan U. The cut was the same as the Soviet naval infantry type cut. However, the camouflage pattern itself was slightly modified. The pattern was shortened. The earliest sample of the Butan U that I found is dated 1995. And as its Soviet predecessor, Butan U has a big variety of colors and shades. And the most interesting piece, in my opinion, is the desert version made for Ukrainian peacekeepers. Later on, some additional changes were made to this pattern, and it went more and more far from the original Soviet Butan. By the late 90s, cut was also changed, as you can see on my uniform that left from the reserve officers training course. However, this was connected with the development of the camouflage pattern, which we will call Dubok. Dubok, which is oak in English, was developed in 1997, and it was completely different camouflage pattern, slightly reminded Butan. As I told you before, the uniform cut also was simplified compared to the Soviet version. However, it still was produced in two versions, with four front pockets for infantry and with only two chest pockets for airborne units, naval infantry or national guards. Dubok also had several desert versions, the most interesting of which you see right now, and it's called Titan. All three types of camouflage patterns, Ukrainian-made Soviet Butan, Butan U and Dubok could be met side by side in Ukrainian army all the way till 2014. Another interesting pattern that been used in Ukrainian army in the 90s was VSR 93 or Barviha, because Barviha was not the first Russian pattern, but the last Soviet pattern. That's why it could be met in Ukrainian National Guard units and in Ukrainian air defense forces. Now let's move to Ukrainian modern camouflage patterns, and we will begin our conversation with Jaba Polivaya, which can be translated as field frog. In 2014, due to the Crimea annexion, 1st Battalion of Ukrainian Naval Infantry was moved from Crimea to Nikolaev. And during that complicated times for Ukrainian Naval Infantry, substantial help was provided by private company Prof. 1 Group, which gave to Ukrainian Marines uniform made in camouflage pattern Jaba Polivaya by P1G TAK. Prof. 1 Group is a big chain of military retail stores in Ukraine, and P1G TAK is their sub-brand, which created Jaba Polivaya in 2012. The year of 2014 itself showed the huge necessity of changes in the Ukrainian army, of course including uniform and equipment. And on August 21st of 2014, in Odessa Military Academy in my hometown, the new uniform in MM14 camouflage pattern was demonstrated. MM14 stands for Malyunok Maskuvalnyy Zrozka 14-го року, which can be translated as Masking Pattern of 2014. And now let's figure out where this MM14 came from. Despite common belief, Ukrainian MM14 camouflage is not a replica of American UCP. And woodland version of this camouflage was trialed in Ukrainian army in 2012 and 2013. I'm not sure who actually created the pattern itself, however the cut was developed by a Norwegian company called NFM. And since this camouflage appeared while the Minister of Defense was Lebedev, let's call it Lebedevka. I personally like Lebedevka, and it reminds me modern Estonian camouflage, or I would say digital flag tarn, and under different circumstances we could have this nice camouflage adopted. Anyway, by 2014 the production of the new uniform, nicknamed Poroh 1 or Giliteika by the name of the Minister of Defense of that time, has been started. Cut and pattern was the same as in Lebedevka, however the colors were changed. And I don't really understand why they kept Norwegian cut, since it was too expensive and too complicated for Ukrainian army. For example, jacket had zipper, velcro and buttons in the same time. It had too much velcro panels and even one mysterious velcro square on the back part, which Ukrainian army has no use for. Pants had double legs similar to the Gorka suit, but on top of that, later on it turned out that this uniform is extremely flammable. So with all these things, Ukrainian Ministry of Defense came to the fact that the uniform should be changed. And by July of 2015, with the help of the Pivanjitak, the new uniform was demonstrated, and this uniform became more practical, more comfortable, and it reminds me Estonian modern uniform or Lithuanian modern uniform. However, it still has some unique features available only in this uniform, and it was demonstrated in two patterns, MM14 like mine and Varan. The main innovation is that now a Ukrainian soldier can choose jacket and pants separately. Uniform produced from two types of fabric, twill and ripstop. I have ripstop, 65% cotton, 35% polyester. Jacket has zipper and velcro. I would remove velcro since they make a lot of noise, and switch zipper to buttons. New uniform has stamped collar. Jacket has four outer pockets, two on the chest and two on the shoulders, and one inner pocket. Chest pockets are passed through. On one side they have zipper and on the other one velcro. Comfortable access in body armor or LCE. Two velcro panels above the chest pockets. One is for the name tape and the second one is for armored forces tape. Rank now is located on the chest. Shoulder pockets remind tactical short shoulder pockets. Have horizontal access and zipper closure. Pocket is also equipped with the velcro panel for patches. Elbows have pockets for the protection inserts. Velcro closures on the cuffs. Pants. Fly with a zipper and Canadian button. Velcro waist adjusters on the sides. Loops are large enough to fit Soviet officer's belt. Two deep front pockets. Two American-style side cargo pockets with velcro closures. Knees have pockets for the protecting inserts. First aid pockets on both sides. Trousers are worn over the boots. This new uniform is very comfortable, does not restrict movement and looks cool. Also, with this 2015 uniforms was developed a new field cap called Mazepinka, named after the Ukrainian hetman Ivan Mazepa. However, this cap reminds not Mazepa's hat, but the field cap of Ukrainian siege riflemen, which based on it. Ukrainian siege riflemen, or in Ukrainian Ukrainski Sichevi Strelci, was an ethnical Ukrainian unit of Austro-Hungarian army during the First World War, which fought on the side of Austro-Hungary, later on participated in the liberation movement of the West Ukrainian National Republic, Ukrainian National Republic, and even for some time fought for the Red Army. Later on, this cap during the Second World War was used by Ukrainian insurgent army, also known as Ukrainska Povstanska Armia or UPA. But since in modern Ukrainian army the old American style field cap is still in use, I prefer this one because first of all I like simple things, second thing I really like American style, and the third thing is that I just don't like this outdated old-fashioned adds to the design. But on the other hand, only since 1917 till 1921, on the territory of the modern Ukraine, there were several states that proclaimed independence. It was Ukrainian National Republic, West Ukrainian National Republic, Ukrainian State, Ukrainian Soviet Socialistic Republic, White Movement, Makhnovia, and even my city became a capital of Odessa Socialist Republic with its own currency and government. So the idea was that even though we all have different Ukraines before, now we all have one. So the uniform of 2015 had not only task of became more comfortable and advanced, but also to combine all these main symbols of the main Ukrainian states. Not all of them, unfortunately, but at least some of them. That's why the new Mazepinka cap is the symbol of the West Ukrainian National Republic. New unit patches are similar to the ones that been used in Ukrainian National Republic. New ranking system reminds us the ranks of the Ukrainian state ruled by Pavel Skoropadsky, ex-general of the Russian Imperial Army, creator of the Ukrainian Naval Infantry and the descender of the Hetman Ivan Skoropadsky, which stayed with Peter the Great during the Poltava battle. Since by 2016 Soviet beret and tilnyashka colors were still in use, we also can talk about Soviet traditions in Ukrainian army. However, by 2017 blue airborne beret was changed to the one in the color called maroon, and by 2018 black naval infantry beret was changed to the one in aquamarine color. And if red or maroon beret is understandable, because even in Soviet Union, like in the rest of the world, before Czechoslovakian invasion, airborne units wore red berets or maroon berets, I don't really understand what was wrong with the black naval infantry beret, because even some NATO countries' naval infantry units wear black or dark blue berets, so I would keep this one. However, this is not the topic of our conversation. And let's come back to the camouflages. Another interesting version of the MM14 camouflage pattern was the MM14 Navy, which is pretty similar to American Navy camouflage. And as I mentioned before, the 2015 uniform was also demonstrated in Varan pattern. Varan camouflage is another camouflage developed by the P1G TAC, and it was tested in 2015 by the 79th Airborne Brigade in Nikolaev. Another interesting Ukrainian camouflage pattern is Hishnik or Hizhak or Predator in English, which was created by the ex-Navy Special Force officer Igor Franchuk in 2012, and Gorka's mate in this pattern is used by some units of the Ukrainian National Guard. Speaking about the Ukrainian National Guard uniforms, after the re-establishment of the Ukrainian National Guard in 2014, they received interesting blue version of the Lebedevka camouflage pattern. However, later they adopted one-tone olive uniform. Few words about the Ukrainian Border Guard camouflages. They had two of them. Earlier one is basically the Ukrainian version of the M81 Woodland, and the later one is very interesting camouflage, which is pretty close to the Lebedevka pattern and was used since 2012-2013, however it was quickly removed after the beginning of the war in Donbas, since it was available on both sides. Now let's talk about Ukrainian body armor. Since the collapse of the Soviet Union and all the way till 2014, Ukrainian troops used Soviet body armor vests. Most popular was 6B3 and 6B5. However, the development of the Corsar family body armor vests began around 1995, but in early stages they were available only for Ukrainian police units or peacekeepers. Like, for example, Corsar M3 model, which was developed specifically for Ukrainian peacekeepers in Kosovo and Iraq. In 2014, Corsair M3S was developed, which was the upgraded version of the Corsair M3 with quick release system and MOLLE interface. However, the massive adoption of the body armor vests made by Temp 3000 began only by 2014 and 2015. And we came all the way to the load carrying equipment. And after the collapse of the Soviet Union, Ukraine got this outdated Soviet load carrying system with this shitty and super uncomfortable shoulder straps, which I used in 2008 while was in military school. And I hate this shit. And unfortunately, this thing still can be spotted in some units of Ukrainian Armed Forces. However, the steps to develop some more comfortable load carrying systems were made since 1994. Now you see one of these early Ukrainian load bearing vests made in orech pattern used by naval infantry. Based on this vest, in 2004 снаряжение десантника SD-1, which can be translated as paratroopers equipment, was developed and used by Ukrainian airborne and some other units. Another interesting Ukrainian load-bearing vest is Pustynia 3 or Desert 3, which was developed for the Ukrainian peacemakers in Iraq, and it was produced in Titan, which is Desert Dubok, regular woodland Dubok, or solid olive. It was adopted by Ukrainian Ministry of Defense in 2008. Another interesting, I would say, chest rig is STS AK-6 chest rig, which was used by some units of the Ukrainian Navy. And now a few words about my favorite RPS Vitesse developed by Sputnik Gear in 2013. RPS Vitesse is Ukrainian vision of the RPS Smersh. The main difference from the Russian RPS Smersh is that the pouches have Velcro closures, which simplifies the process of readjustment or reassembling. RPS Vitesse was popular with 8 special purpose regiment, naval infantry units and volunteers. And we came all the way to the helmets. And of course, even today, the main helmets of the Ukrainian Armed Forces are Soviet SH-68 and SH-60 and even SH-40. However, since 2015, Ukrainian Ministry of Defense actively adopting 1M helmet made by Temp 3000, which was developed and actively trialed in the beginning of the 2000s. Okay, comrades, so I hope you like this video. Put like, comment, subscribe to my channel, and see you soon. Мене одні, мене живі, виключить нас.